I am still here, as much as you try to sap me. I'm unsappable. I'm a spectral knight. I cannot be targeted by spells or hero.
Nice. Yeah.
See, I know some things about Hearthstone. Sotl is still with me as well.
Yeah.
We're a little tired.
We're getting up there. Getting up towards what the 9-hour cast at this point, something along those lines.
Yeah.
It's getting up there. We're getting the job done though. We have one more series left to go, so let's not moan about how long we've had to be casting for. Let's get excited about the awesome series that we've not only seen already, but the one more that we have to come.
Well, exactly. Part of the reason why it's run so long is all these series with all these incredibly talented players. I mean, this lineup is absolutely stacked with some of the best players in the world, a lot of the best players in the world. A lot of them have gone to 3-2 just because these players are at such a high skill level, and a lot of them very evenly matched. Six out of the seven so far have gone to 3-2. Let's see if Firebat and Ecop can replicate that. Of course, Firebat newly teamless, the only teamless player in this tournament, going up against Cloud9's Ecop. We have the lineups and bans for you now. So Ecop brought Warlock, Paladin, and Warrior, and his Druid was banned. And Firebat has brought Mage, Druid, and Warrior, and the Rogue is banned. Now, I would be safe to assume, I think, that it's Freeze Mage from Firebat, although I did say earlier that Europeans tend to favor Freeze Mage rather than North Americans for tempo.
Yeah.
Firebat has long played the Freeze Mage, has always been a proponent of the Freeze Mage.
Yeah, he is an avid Freeze Mage player, and as I've made the point several times during this broadcast, when you are an expert at one of these high-skill decks, you know, we're talking Rogue, Freeze Mage, Patron Warrior, etc., you tend to bring it to every tournament you can because you feel like you just have the scope to outplay people with the high skill deck. And I know that is a position that Firebat definitely considers is real. We see him actually bringing Rogue and probably Freeze Mage to this lineup.
Yeah, and the Rogue that Firebat brought has been banned, which we talked a little bit about respect bans early on. If I was going to ban Firebat's Rogue, I would think a lot of that is somewhat a respect ban because Firebat is such an accomplished and well-practiced Rogue player. What do you think of that ban from Ecop? Do you think it has something to do with his lineup, or is it more down to the skill?
It's interesting. As I said, I'm not really a fan of the kind of respect ban strategy, but looking at Ecop's lineup, Secret Paladin is a deck that Rogue does pretty well against if it can get the right early removals to line up. And then there's the potential for his Warlock to be Zoo as well, and then maybe Ecop is one of those people that believes Rogue is moderately favored against Druid as well. So Rogue has the potential to do very well against his lineup from his perspective. I could understand the ban there, but sure, there might just be a level of respect for Firebat as a Rogue player just to ban it out here. But that would surprise me to ban out something that's considered one of the weaker classes, you know, definitely probably bottom half of the classes in the game in terms of power level at the moment, just because you respect one of the player's skill with it. So I'd expect he's looking at his lineup and thinking that it can pick apart a lot of his decks.
It was interesting, Firebat was talking in his stream. We've talked a lot about Firebat's stream today. You should all check out Firebat's stream. It's very good.
It is really good, yeah.
He was on his stream the other day while he was playing some Rogue and talking about how he views the class tier list at the moment, which is that Druid and Paladin are tier 1.
Mm-hmm.
Shaman is a little bit above everything else, he thinks, which I thought was interesting. I'm not sure what you think about that.
Wait, Shaman?
Yeah.
Say that again?
He said Druid and Paladin are tier 1.
Yeah.
Everything else is vaguely the same, but Shaman is a little bit above.
Shaman's a little bit above. Interesting.
Yeah, but he said that, you know, Rogue definitely isn't a good deck right now, but it's also not necessarily that much worse than everything else, because everything else is kind of much of a muchness.
Yeah, I mean, interesting stuff. I'm like, the Shaman thing standing out there is a little bit weird to me, but yeah, I mean, I can understand that analysis. I'm sure Firebat has some sort of serious basis for that beyond his opinion. He is a guy that is very, very focused on the statistical side of Hearthstone, values hard data over people's opinions on how things work most of the time. So I'm sure if he's making that statement, he has some sort of backup for it. But yeah, it seems a little bit weird to me to value Shaman that highly, but definitely a very effective deck. But we've seen 16 very high-profile, very talented Hearthstone players in this tournament. And how many Shamans exactly have we seen?
One less than the amount of Hunters that we've seen.
Yeah, which, to be clear, is one Hunter and zero Shamans.
No Priests either.
No Priests, yeah, you're quite right. So
no Priest, no Shaman, one Hunter, a smattering of Rogue.
Yeah, a smattering of Rogue. I like it. So yeah, the meta is starting to boil down a little bit as we await for Standard to come out to the kind of Druid, Warlock, paladin, a little bit of mage, a little bit of rogue, and the other classes are just kind of suffering a bit. And warrior, of course. Sorry, I left out. So,
speaking of warrior,
yeah,
Ecop considering conning out the death spite here to clean up this 2-4. Still have the armorsmith as well, and obviously, just checking the wild growth there. From Firebat's side, Ecop, I know, is quite tired. He was slightly miffed at the delays, and since he has to play last, is very late in Germany. It's almost after half past midnight now.
Yep. Sorry, I actually didn't realize the game had started. My viewer here of the feed was just locked up for a second, but it's all good. We're back in now. So we have what looks like Patron Warrior game one up against Druid. Classic matchup at this point. It's been played to death from both sides, but both decks have evolved significantly since it started. But we've come out to the point where it's pretty much agreed that the Patron Warrior is a little bit favored in this matchup, but Firebat, unable to really get too much aggression going early on, is gonna need to ramp up the damage and the pressure as soon as he can here.
Yeah, so how do you think this matchup stands now?
I think it's like a clean 55, maybe even better to the Patron Warrior at this point. They're just in a really good position. They have all these just extra tempo cards in the deck now that Druids struggle to deal with. Dread Corsair for zero mana, etc., things like that, Piloted Shredders, early Frothing Berserkers, plus the threat that everyone knows because it's hammered to death every time people see this matchup. Druids just can't deal with Grim Patrons. We know this to be true, but the thing with the deck now is that they have all these additional threats alongside that that can just help to tempo Druid out of the game.
Yeah, things like Piloted Shredders that are very hard for Druid to deal with, other than by trading minions and losing them on board presence.
Yeah.
So this is a little bit of a difficult turn for Ecop here. Lots of options with, he could Frothing Berserker, hit the 2-4 and Whirlwind to hit even more, and then kill the 4-2. You should probably Whirlwind before the Deathbite to get more procs on the Frothing Berserker. But he also has Lotheb, has a Shredder. What kind of line do you favor here?
Yeah, it's a little bit awkward. Nothing really lines up perfectly. I think I'm just Balraging this turn. Maybe just taking out the 4-2 and using the 2 spare mana to draw 2 cards with Balrage. Looks like, yeah, that's what Ecop's going to go down as well. It still leaves a competitive minion on the board. You have a 5-3 up against a 2-3 here. Draw 2 additional cards. Start to get yourself closer to those patrons that you need as an ultimate win condition in this matchup. And you're also asking your Druid opponent to do something about the board on their turn 7, which is very beneficial to disrupt them from the power play.
Yeah, absolutely. Turn 7 is such a huge moment for the Druid to play either Ancient of Lore or Dr. Broom, but Firebat going to go ahead and just play it and draw the cards. Nice. As a Lotheb and Shade now for turn 8, which is going to work out pretty well.
Yeah. He's going to innovate the hero power here, so unfortunately for Ecop, he should theoretically disrupt the power play on turn 7, but unfortunately Druid has access to fun cards like Innovate that can make magical things possible.
Fun and interactive.
Indeed.
Well, Shredder Armorsmith feels pretty good here.
Yeah, nice immediate refill onto the board. The Armorsmith does immediately get contested by the 5-5, so it's fairly low value. You may want to hold onto it, just considering that you have the Whirlwind in hand. It might be able to gain you more value later on than the one that it will, the immediate death to the 5-5 here. But you also feel like you need to do that one extra damage to the 5-5 in order to have the Shredder trade into it effectively. So I can understand him playing it out.
There is the Dr. Boom picked up just after turn 7, but it's still good on turn 8.
Yeah, I mean, if you play some combination of Ancient and Lore and Dr. Boom on turn 7 and 8, you feel pretty good as a Druid player, honestly. So the fact that the Dr. Boom comes out on turn 8 there, not a big deal.
And we could just see a trade and a Counter Boom here.
Yeah, no.
How do you feel about Counter Boom generally?
It's a play to go even on the board, right? Like, It's you can't have any sort of optimism that it's going to come out better than that. And, what it's saying is like, okay, I've whiffed on my Big Game Hunter, my Execute, whatever it is that I have in my deck to deal with a Dr. Boom. I'm just going to hope that you don't have it as well and that they trade from that scenario. But you give the initiative back to your opponent and hand them, all the options as to how they want to deal with it. So usually it's not ideal, but in some situations, like possibly this one, it's the best play that you have available. He can just choose to take out the 7-7 now with the War Axe and the Shredder, but then that leaves the 5-4 up, so it's not even significantly better. So maybe we do just end up with the counter boom here, but he may feel like he has to low feb to play around threat of the combo.
It's very true. How much would the combo be at this point? 9
more,
extra
plus more six. Than enough. Yeah.
So it'd be 29.
Yeah. But yeah, he's going to feel like he can't win the game if he makes that slow play. If he just develops a 5-5 onto the board here, he's just conceding so much tempo to his opponent if, say, he doesn't have combo and just has a handful of more minions to play. So yeah, I think this is definitely the play to win, even though I just described that it's less than ideal. His hand is less than ideal for the situation right now.
Yeah.
This is kind of the best of a bad bunch of plays that he can make right now.
Well, it looks like Firebat's going for the low flip instead. Even though Ecop opted against it, and a Shredder right in the middle so Sottl doesn't get tilted.
Hey, I don't mind. You can put your Shredders wherever you want, especially if it helps irritate Twitch chat. This amuses me. I actually got into the habit of deliberately placing Shredders wrong to tilt my personal stream chat, and then I was playing AK Wonder at DreamHack in a 6-2 game, and he came up to me afterwards and was like, by the way, dude, like, you should really start putting your Shredders in the middle, because like, it can really, like, it might win you, like, one game out of 100 or something. And I was like, oh, goddamn, I didn't even realize that, like, my habit of triggering my own Twitch chat has actually bled into my competitive play, and I'm now just placing Shredders wrong. Like,
all right, I'm putting you down to rank 6 for that story.
Oh, what? What? That's
you're getting close to my level.
Okay, all right.
I'm gonna step it up.
I'll keep working hard. Maybe I can get down there one day with a lot of hard work and patience.
It takes a lot of determination and hard work to be this terrible Hearthstone.
Alright. Boombot to face for 1 damage. Fairly inconsequential. Does get him inching closer to that magical 14 number. Second Boombot goes face for 3. He can't armor up out of range anymore. So Force of Nature top deck is possibly going to get the party started here. So now Ecop is going to concede that the Lothab has to be played here to try and fight for this board. And it's much more competitive on this board than it was on the previous turn, after the War Axe deals with the 2-3 and the 7-7s trade with each other.
Yeah, as you see, had no choice but to play the Lothab there. Is that not still lethal, though?
With
the Hero Power and Savage Roar? Yeah.
Yeah, just Savage Roar and Hero Power will get the job done. So I think he had a 4-minion board and both Boombots ended up going face, which is pretty unfortunate. They only did 4 damage overall, which is a little below average of the roll, but the mere fact that they both hit face is from Ecop's perspective.
Yeah, a little bit unfortunate for Ecop there, losing his Warrior. So he's going to have his Paladin and his Warlock to go into the Druid now.
Paladin and Warlock to pick into Druid. I suspected, based on the Rogue ban, that his Warlock is a quicker Warlock, probably a Zoo, so seems like that is the most likely pick here, but if it does turn out that that is more of a control Warlock, then he'll probably go towards the Paladin. And we've just been told he is, in fact, picking the Paladin.
Yeah, I mean, it could be both, and it could just be that he thinks the secret Paladin, or whatever Paladin it is that he's bringing, is really favored against the Druid, or he feels good with it against the Druid.
Mm-hmm. There's also the possibility that maybe he's just trying to pick up a more than one win with a deck and feels that maybe Paladin is a better option to run into the Freeze Mage than the Zoo would be, which would kind of be the natural counter if he won a deck with Zoo. But there's a number of possibilities here. It may be a more controlling Warlock that would lose to Druid. It might just be the play to try and pick up 2 wins with a deck here instead of 1. But we'll see as the series develops, but what we do know for now is that he's running with Paladin into the Druid of Firebat. And this is a matchup that we've already seen several times can get swung and live or die by the power of the Big Game Hunter against the Mysterious Challenger.
Yeah, I think it was was it Ryzen versus Sho we saw this matchup first?
Yeah, it was Ryzen versus Sho where he got the immediate snipe by the Avenge hitting the Mysterious Challenger. And then we also saw Hoi navigate it really well by just letting the competitive spirit proc. Just developing the Sylvanas on the board, BGHing the Challenger on a following turn instead. So there's a number of ways you can go about it. Firebat does have that Big Game Hunter in his opening hand, probably a little bit ambitious to hold on to it, but there's a consideration with it for sure, because it is such a swingy card in the matchup. If you don't have it and the Challenger situation comes down and you don't already have an overwhelming board, it's a whole world of trouble sometimes. But he does choose to mulligan it away, he just holds on to the swipe instead.
Yeah, and we see a second swipe coming into hand as well as a Keeper of the Grove.
Mm.
So they might all cost 4 mana, it's a little bit clunky, but lots of answers in hand for Firebat.
Yeah, he has a lot of answers. The problem is he just can't get there very quickly right now. He wants the innovates and world growth to go along with this stuff so that he can, you know, speed up the tempo of these clunky four mana cards, like you said. But an innovate top deck this turn, maybe to snipe out the keeper, snipe out the secret keeper with the keeper of the grove. Nope, no such luck. So slow start from the druid, and it will probably get punished by this start from Ekop, because he has the early minions into being able to bank that Blessing of Kings on turn four on a minion.
Yeah, Blessing of Kings as a four drop in this deck is, it does feel quite weird to just play it and go face a lot of the time, or just as a tempo play, rather than some kind of finisher, which is, you normally think of things like Power Overwhelming, they're generally used to trade up or as a finisher, not just as a straight tempo play, but it does work quite a lot of the time, especially if you can get it on something like a Shielded Minibot.
Right. The key with Blessing of Kings is that it actually is a huge health buff as well, so it actually makes the minions simultaneously difficult to remove while being more aggressive. You know, things like Abusive Sergeant, obviously it doesn't increase the health, so you very rarely see it just get used to just push face. It's also not a permanent buff, but Power Overwhelming, of course, just the minion naturally dies at the end of the turn, so you're encouraged to trade with it. But Blessing of Kings just creates this huge body because it's +4/+4. If your opponent doesn't have a silence, they're in serious trouble. So, yeah, jamming kings on four and going face is a winning play a lot of the time.
And say a king's shielded minibot is very hard to deal with.
Yes, it's one of the nightmares for a control priest, for example, which is very favored in this matchup overall. But you know, say the minibot is played and you have turn three Deathlord. If the turn four Blessing of Kings then comes down on that minibot and helps him break through the Deathlord, you can pretty much lose the game there and then if the Deathlord RNG doesn't go in your favor.
I'm always Firebat looking at from his answers here. Let's see, he has the two swipes and the Keeper of the Grove. Is this going to silence the Secret Keeper?
Looks that way. So he's making the play here that doesn't let the Avenge go off, if that's what it was, but turns out it's Repentance, so no big deal, doesn't really lose a high-value minion to it, but there was the risk of Avenge, where if he shot down the shielded minibot just cleanly with the two damage, then the Avenge would just increase the amount of power on the board anyway.
So do you go for the Kings here on four? And you can trade one of the one-attack minions into the 2-1 and then just Blessing of Kings the 2-2 and go face?
Yeah, I'm all about that. All about that Blessing of King's life right now. Having seen one silence, there's also the consideration of just jamming it on the creeper, because you make, you know, once you take silence out of the equation, actually putting buffs on a death rattle minion is an appealing prospect, because you force your opponent to deal with a minion that's going to stick around afterwards. You know, they're forced to take that power off the board from the creeper, but if they do, the minions are just spawned anyway. But Ekop's going to go down the different line here, get the buff on the Secret Keeper, and get the extra 1/1s in play anyway. This is a tiny bit more exposed to Swipe, but not much, because Swipe will still leave behind that giant 5/6.
Yeah. And, I mean, Firebat, he doesn't really have anything else to do other than Swipe.
Yeah, so might as well do it, but I would imagine... I'm going to go for the mini-bot here. Interesting. I thought he might consider swiping the 5/6 to set up for swipe number 2 next turn. But it looks like he's not going down that line. He's just going to swipe out the 2/2. Which means he's probably hoping to play Druid of the Claw next turn, and then use that to set up swipe number 2 on the following turn. But this Muster for Battle might just accelerate his plans.
Yeah, I was just going to say... It's still not great for Firebat, so it's not amazing, but Ekop has somewhat potentially played into the second swipe with the Muster for Battle, but Firebat sticks to the plan, goes for the Druid of the Claw, and I think we're just going to see Challenger here. Would make sense. I mean, what else are you going to do? Avenge, Hero Power Pass. Interesting, there's still four secrets, so there is Redemption and Competitive Spirit as well as Repentance, so Ekop's likely playing... seven
most likely, yeah. Second Avenge in hand, but yeah, we've already seen the Repentance come out, and with him still getting four secrets, like you said, that means the Redemption is there alongside the usual ones that you'd... the Competitive Spirit is there alongside the usual ones that you'd expect to see, and the big brutal package of, you know, any attack you make increases my power on the board, that Redemption, Avenge, Noble Sacrifice combo. No big game hunter drawn here for Firebat, so his swipe that he has in his hand is looking a little bit insufficient. And yeah, he's just going to go ahead and concede here. Scoots out, Ecop levels up the series, and Firebat now has to find an answer for this secret paladin.
Yeah, it's not going to be easy. What does he have left? He has the mage and the warrior.
Yep.
So it's freeze mage, and I don't know. What does Firebat favor in warrior? I can't say I've seen him play too much warrior.
He's played a good amount of patrons. I've seen him play patron on stream. I've seen him play patron in a tournament lineup. So I definitely would favor that. My default position at the moment anyway, I just think patron warrior is a more powerful deck than control warrior in tournament format. I would be surprised. I was surprised to see the control warrior come out from purple, so I would be surprised to see the control warrior come out again, but let's just wait and see, I guess. I would expect this to be a freeze mage pick fairly often, though, unless it's a patron warrior, in which case that's a really, really nice counter to the secret paladin.
All right, we'll wait and see what these guys are going to pick. Obviously, it's going to be the paladin for Ecop, and Firebat is going for the mage.
Interesting. Okay. So, I mean, I'm personally of the opinion that patron warrior is secret paladin's worst matchup, but I know a lot of really strong freeze mage players are of the opinion that freeze mage destroys this deck, but there seems to be a pattern in tournaments. It happened fairly often in the EU and NA regionals, I believe. I know it for sure happened in EU while I was casting, where you talk about how effective freeze mage should be against secret paladin, and then the secret paladin just blows it out anyway. So,
well, we had this, you know, when we last cast together in the HS Arena tournament, I remember we were talking about everyone should just ban paladin because it's really difficult. But then 6-0 came in with, I think, patron, and was it zoo or handlock that was really strong at that point against secret paladin?
I believe he was playing handlock at the time.
Yeah, so he was playing handlock, patron, and face hunter,
right?
Which we all thought were good matchups against secret paladin. Yeah. And he still lost 3-0.
Yeah, for sure. That was a very different secret paladin deck back then. Much more aggressive, more people, you know, running like the Lepinomes and Abusives and Double Divine Favor, etc. It was a different age back then. Now the deck just plays the best minion in the game for each mana cost and beats you that way. So, not sure. Pick your poison, right? Would you rather die to Lepinome or just the best minion in the game every turn?
Well, we have Secret Keeper and Shield of Minibot on 2. Into potentially Shredder or Alderman, but I think Ecop is considering the double shielded minibot, which is also not a bad play.
Yeah, double minibot seems powerful here for sure. With no secrets in hand, that Secret Keeper isn't going to be a significant threat anytime soon, but I think he's just a little bit worried about maybe what his turn 3 is here. If he goes coin minibot into minibot, he'd then be looking at like maybe Secret Keeper hero power on turn 3, but he has time to pick up a play if he does, so I'm okay with both lines here. I think maybe I'd go with the coin minibot line here, if it was me.
Well, it looks like that's what Ecop is going to go for. I do like keeping the coin for the 4 drops when you don't have a turn 3 play.
Mm.
It's definitely worthy of consideration. Both lines potentially very good. And Firebat snap Doomsayer here.
Yeah. And this is we talked about the tempo Doomsayer in Freeze Mage in a previous series, and it was used, I believe was it Zalay that used them? Without freeze effects on the board, he just jammed them out. Yeah, and he wasn't setting up anything with that play. He didn't have a minion to play afterwards. But in this situation, you can see that if this Doomsayer was to go off, which you're highly expecting it to do, Firebat just gets to play Acolyte of Pain or Arcane Intellect on an empty board, which is a really nice tempo play here.
Yeah, also, it feels like a really good time to play the Temple Doomsayer when you've seen a coin 2 drop.
Yeah.
Because you're pretty obviously telegraphing you have a second 2 drop.
Right.
So you deny that. You deny that extra 2 drop. And you are going to see, you know, the Secret Keeper and the Minibot potentially here on turn 3. So you do get it down just a turn later, but it disrupts the momentum and makes things a little bit more difficult for your opponent. Yeah, I did say about Zoli earlier that he used the Doomsayers a little bit too cautiously, I think, or a little bit... He was a little bit too quick to use those Doomsayers and maybe could have let his life total go a little bit lower and have those Doomsayers for a little bit later.
Yep.
But we'll see. But
let's not forget he ended up winning that game after we ruled him out multiple times. So let's not naysay the play too much, but
definitely not the only time we've done that today.
No, speaking of naysaying plays, I'm not a big fan of Secret Keeper Shielded Minibot here because you just give that Acolyte of Pain 3 draws, essentially, if Firebat wants it. He gets the dream Acolyte if he would really like it here. He can attack into the Secret Keeper, ping his own Acolyte of Pain, get that 3 draw Acolyte going, and it looks like that's exactly what Firebat's gonna do.
And he can novice here as well and get three draws this turn.
Yeah. I hope you like my
invention. Seems good.
So yeah, I don't know how I feel about that. Obviously, the alternate play was to do something involving Noble Sacrifice, but at least then the Acolyte is hitting a two-attack minion in the form of the Defender and not attacking into a one-attack minion. He's going to pass up the ping here since he drew that Mad Scientist. Mad Scientist is so much better for tempo, so I like it. Turns out the Acolyte is not going to get the three draws, but the important thing is that Firebat had the option, and it was only that great draw of the Mad Scientist that prevented him taking the extra draw.
This is a little bit awkward for Ecop here. How does he try to deal with this board? Does have the Keeper of Old Man to build up the power on the board and just... he can just go face if he wants. He can also buff up the Secret Keeper to prevent multiple draws coming from the Acolyte now. But the ping is still an option, so it doesn't really do anything.
No, I think you probably have to respect this Acolyte at this point. Just trade it out so it doesn't get two additional draws. And the mini-bot is going to end up going face here. I don't see... Oh, he's actually going to trade into the Scientist, which is... I guess he's protecting his Secret Keeper, but trading against a Scientist, against a Freeze Mage, is always kind of a feels-bad-man situation. But I guess he's just valuing having that Secret Keeper in play, because of course it does lock out the manual playing of Secrets from... Well, not lock out, but it punishes the manual playing of secrets from the Freeze Mage's side as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And things are lining up pretty well for Firebat here. He's managed to curve into his draw very well. Has a second Arcane Intellect to play, as well as a Forgotten Torch. So if the Shredder comes down, you can use the Torch in the first part of the Shredder and then Arcane Intellect. It's not a bad turn at all. You also have the ability to use Ice Barrier to mitigate damage or to get your first Ice Block in, which you do have to do at some point.
Ice Block's already
but
up.
Yeah, sorry, Block's up, so it's not green right now. It wasn't his turn, so I couldn't see which secret it was that was not green.
Well, he just got attacked in the face and Barrier didn't go off.
That's true.
That was probably a pretty good indicator.
That did give it away.
Yeah. So Firebat is going to Arcane Intellect here, as you suggested, and may just decide to go ahead and take down that Shredder. No, he's going to play the manual Ice Barrier here. There's 9 damage on the board. You know, generally a rule of thumb is a manual Ice Barrier is usually solid when there's less than the 8 that you gain on the board, but he does just immediately concede that 1 point of damage here, but feels like he needs to get the Ice Barriers developed sooner rather than later just to make sure he does get the value off of them. And he has, unfortunately, manually drawn 3 of his 4 secrets with only that one Ice Block being pulled from the Mad Scientist.
Yeah, that's not worked out too well for him. But the rest of his hand is pretty decent. Picks up the Alexstrasza, which is a good pickup at this point. It's maybe it's a turn or two too early for you to play it, but you want to have it in hand around this time.
Yeah, he is a turn or two away, but he definitely has the hand building up to be able to seal this if he can find the turn or two he needs to stall. He has plenty of burn damage built up. He does have the Alex. He's just missing those freeze effects to be able to lock out his mid-game turns.
He's missing the second phase. That's... I was just going to go back to...
Callum's three-phase guide to freeze mage.
Well, it's TJ's three-phase guide.
Okay,
I do give him credit.
Right.
Firebat drew really well in the early game. He had a lot of draw. The Mad Scientist, the Acolyte went really well. The Arcane Intellects both went off. He has the burn in his hand, but he doesn't have the freezes. And I talked earlier about turns 5, 6, and 7. The Doomsayer, Frost Nova, Blizzard, Flamestrike to be able to control the board.
Right.
He hasn't picked up any of those pieces. So that's, you would think, at least 7 cards. At least 6, probably 7 cards that he hasn't drawn into any part of that.
Blessing of Kings represents a ton of damage being pushed forward here. So he has 7, 11, 14, 18 damage total this turn, and 19 with the Muster for Battle as well. So still a fair way short of being able to pop through that Ice Barrier and activate the first Ice Block. But the Blessing of Kings is just such a huge tempo play here as well that I'd be surprised to see it not used.
Yeah, so we put him to 11 here. And obviously you have a lot of damage on the board to potentially come back the next turn, and as we know, there is no AoE or freeze apart from an Ice Lance and 2 Frostbolts. There's no AoE freeze in the hand.
Yep, so he is going to jam the Kings. Looks like he's choosing to play it on the 3-4 here. So what does that mean? What's he going to use to trade into the Acolyte in that case? Because it feels like that 3-4 was the natural target to just take out this Acolyte of Pain. Like, is he just going to go full face here, or what's happening?
Yes, takes out the Ice Barrier, down.
He's gonna go for the card. He's gonna go for the card burn, which is always an interesting dilemma. Like, what the balance between burning two of your opponent's cards for the card. Okay, I mean, he's drawing two cards to burn two cards here, which is an acceptable situation, I guess.
Oh, Antonidas and Blizzard as well.
Yeah, the Blizzard probably much more important there, but the fact that he can burn two cards probably makes it worth it. Just burning one to draw your opponent two on average isn't worth it, because you just draw them twice as many resources as you're getting rid of. And you see there, the Frost Nova was drawn into, which does create that one still turn he needs. So now the block is not going to get popped this turn. The board is full, which means there is very little the Secret Paladin can do this turn, and we are going to see this deck game progress very quickly down the path of Alexstrasza to face, followed by a big old pile of burn damage.
Yeah, so how do we weave in the burn here? We can Alexstrasza on 9, and then...
Then you kill him.
Yeah.
Fireball, Frostbolt, Ice Lance is lethal from that point, so
yes.
You're all good.
There is a True Silver though, so what, does that affect things?
So Fireball, Frostbolt, Ice Lance is 6, 9, 12, 16, and you don't have the mana to ping as well. So the True Silver will pull him one out of range, yes.
So do you then, if, you know, so he's going to do the True Silver now, so he's going to try and get the... I don't know about that.
Wait, never mind. He has the Forgotten Torch in hand as well. Does that change anything? No, I don't think so. Yeah.
No, it represents the same amount of damage as the second Frostbolt.
Yeah.
I don't know if I wouldn't keep the True Silver until after Alex.
Yeah. Healing. Seems right to want to get both heals out of it, but I guess he's just going to respect the Scientist here. Gets rid of it. And so Alex will come down here. That True Silver will pull him out of range, but he still has chances to pick up lethal. And even so, the block is being popped, and he does have the ration here to be able to just do half his burn plus ice block on the following turn. If Ekop is playing Lotheb in his deck, he needs to make sufficient room on his board here to make sure that Lotheb can be played on the following turn if it's drawn. He needs to deal with this Alexstrasza. He needs to pop the ice block, and he needs to heal for two. And just hope and pray that Firebat has not assembled all the burn pieces that he needs.
Yeah, essentially that is what he needs to do. So he goes up to 17 here. He can clear. Yeah, we'll see if he's playing... If he just clears with these two Shredders, we know he's not playing Lotheb.
It would suggest that way, yeah. It looks like he is going to create the room on his board. I think trading off the 1-1s here makes a lot of sense. Maybe the 2-1 and 2-1-1s. Is the way to do this last 4 damage. You keep that one death rattle minion on board as well, just in case it does come down to the situation where Firebat needs a board clear. But yeah, the most important thing here is to make that room on your board. I think we even saw Lotheb in the previous game, maybe from Ekop, but yeah, the important thing from his perspective, make sure you have that room on the board, because Lotheb may be your only out from this situation.
I don't know if it wasn't Ekop's warrior we saw the Lotheb.
That's very possible too, yeah.
Yeah, it's... Yeah, so the block does get popped here.
Yeah. Gets popped at 4, which isn't exactly ideal, but, you know, primarily he got the job done. He killed the Alex. He popped the block. He's left the space open on the board. And that Ice Lance draw is going to end the game. Awesome.
Fireball, double Frostbolt, double Ice Lance. Yep. More than enough burn. And we talked about Firebat's mastery of the Freeze Mage deck, and he did really show it here.
Certainly did, yeah.
Excellent Freeze Mage work here.
But even without that Ice Lance, the game was more or less a formality. Ekop would have needed pretty much exactly Lotheb off the top to prevent just lethal that one turn. It would have swung the game hugely, but like we said, he had the ability to play the second Ice Block and then just throw a small amount of burn with his remaining mana at face, and then he had the Pyroblast set up. He had more Fireballs and Ice Lances and Frostbolts and stuff in hand, so plenty of damage to cover him over two turns alongside the Ice Block anyway.
A difficult Freeze Mage for Firebat. A difficult game for him on the Freeze Mage. Didn't get any of the freeze that he needed in the early game. It was really... If he hadn't drawn that Frost Nova when he did, I don't know, the game might have slipped away from him a little bit. Just that damage coming in a little bit earlier.
Yeah, very true. It wasn't completely smooth. I'll give him that. But he did get a really strong early draw. He got the Doomsayer into the Acolyte of Pain, into the Arcane Intellect, etc. But he did miss out on that key mid game where he just needed.
And drawing the scientists as well.
Drawing the secrets. As well. Yeah. Drew the secrets instead of all the key AOE like Blizzard and Frost Nova Doomsayer, like you said. But you know, it's hard to complain too much. Like, you know, woe is Firebat, I think not. He did have a very, very powerful opening hand there against the Secret Paladin. So, is able to clutch it out. Like you said, picked up that really important Frost Nova at just the right time to buy that one turn that he needed. And that is very much what Freeze Mage is about. Find that one turn.
Well, it's going to be the Warlock of Ecop now against the Freeze Mage of Firebat. Interesting to see. I'll be interested to see what Warlock Ecop has brought that he didn't necessarily pick it earlier.
Yeah, the most important thing, strangely, about like what Warlock this is now is that it reflects on Ecop's decision making earlier in the series. Not so much right now. Obviously, the Reno will have a much better chance against Freeze Mage than Zoo would, for example. And from my personal perspective, I would love to see it be Reno here because I think Reno Lock versus Freeze Mage is probably the best matchup in the game in terms of overall depth of strategy and flexibility and things to talk about from a casting perspective as well. So I'd love to see the Reno Lock come out here, but let's just wait and see from Ecop, I guess.
Definitely lots to talk about, maybe not at 1 a.m. Central European time.
Dot Bomb seems to indicate that we are looking at a Reno Lock. Yes, indeed. Do you want me to take this one, Callum?
You can pilot this one, I think.
All right, cool.
What is the strategy here from either side?
So on the surface, you look at this matchup and say, this should be really horrible for Freeze Mage, right? Like they have Healbot, they have Reno, they might have a Bran in there as well to make the Healbot heal for 16, you know, all this gross stuff. But when you start to go in a little bit deeper, what you can do is just buy the Warlock tapping a little bit naturally. You can lower them to around 20 HP quite quickly. And then once they're down at 20 HP, you can just, you know, have a big hand of cards, and you're kind of threatening lethal from that kind of range anyway with Freeze Mage's kind of max burn potential. Especially if you're playing an Emperor list, you can just kind of jam Emperor and just say, okay, you know, even if it's a bluff, you can say, okay, I've just Emperored a handful of burn. You're dead next turn. And then at that point, you're forcing them to Healbot or Reno already. So your goal of the Freeze Mage is to get them to heal preemptively and Alex afterwards. It's like this big giant game of chicken where the Warlock is trying to be as greedy as possible and the Mage is trying to force the heal to come out before the Alex draft.
I know we're playing in Salt Calum's intelligence today and that's fine.
Yeah.
But I'm pretty sure I did explain this earlier on.
Did you?
Yeah, in the last Reno game.
Okay.
That if you can get your opponent to Reno before you then Alexstrasza, then you have a really good chance to win the game. Also, you can just win the game by them tapping to within range and not being able to get out of range and then just win without having to play Alex.
I think this was a matchup that wasn't Freeze Mage, but I'll give you the benefit of the doubt here, Callum. You do know a thing or two every now and again. I'll let you have this victory.
Okay.
But yeah, the point is that you have to kind of react to the situation. It's even more complex after all that because the idea of hoarding cards and trying to build up this big burn combo or the threat of a big burn combo in your hand relies on the Reno Lock not having too much of an aggressive draw, which we see here. Ecop is very quickly moving into these heavy mid-game threats, the Fugan and the Sludge Belcher. So he's actually going to have a lot of ball presence as well, which forces Firebat to react and maybe spend less time drawing cards, more time answering the board. So in this sort of situation where you're forced to play from behind a little bit, it does kind of create the scenario where sometimes you do have to just do the all-in Alexstrasza and just hope your opponent hasn't drawn their Reno or Healbot yet. So it really is about reacting to the state of the match, and the whole thing's permanently in flux, and I just personally find it like really entertaining to watch. So.
Well, it's the same as we were talking about a hypothetical Reno mirror.
Yeah.
If you know that your opponent's playing the Leroy combo, for example, you can't really wait until you're much lower than 20-ish to Reno.
Yeah.
Because you can never be that low. Which is a bit like playing against old school Leroy Handlock and Miracle Rogue. So this decision here, the Owl on the Doomsayer is an option for Ecop here.
It protects just precisely 147. He gets to develop an Imp Gang boss alongside it if he wants to, but it looks like Ecop's going to value the tap here over developing the extra 2/4 minion onto board. But he is going to owl away the Doomsayer. That 4-7 is a nice minion to protect, just to have beating away. Like I said, the worst case scenario here, the thing you don't want is an empty board that the Freeze Mage just gets to manipulate in any way they like. Just start hoarding cards, build up that burn combo. But speaking of building up burn combo, we see Fireball, Frostbolt in hand already. We see
this, and Forgotten Torch.
And we see that this is an Antonidas list, which is a little bit different from what we've been seeing from the other people so far who've been playing the straight burn list that Cross has popularized recently. So he definitely has the potential to go down that route. I suspect this list will play Emperor in it as well, due to the Antonidas being there. So he definitely has that opportunity to go down the route of saying, you know, I'm going to build up a big old pile of burn in my hand and then just Emperor my hand and force you to react.
A little bit of poker here from these two players. You know, Ecop silences one Doomsayer and Farbot says, okay, well, I'll raise you a second Doomsayer. Mm. Are you going to commit resources to another Doomsayer? And Ecop says, well, okay, well, let's do that. We'll Hellfire and then we'll trade, protecting this minion on the board, protecting this board development. And it's the same that we talked about with the Water Elemental and the...
Wow!
That's a turn 7 Antonidas.
Sorry to interrupt you, Kerr Callum, but Firebat has just like whipped it out and slammed it on the table, both literally and metaphorically here, Callum. He has just unzipped and just slapped it straight in Ecop's face. And Ecop is not impressed. He has the answer. Dismisses it immediately with the Siphon Soul.
Yeah, that's...
That was ambitious.
Yeah, I was going to say, let's talk about that thought process a little bit. Because that's very interesting to me. That's not something you generally think would be a play.
No. He started the turn. He picked up the Forgotten Torch in his hand. So he was just intending to Forgotten Torch and ping down the minion in play, which is what he ended up doing on the following turn. So what exactly his mentality was there? Like, here's what happened. He got the information from his opponent's previous turn that he didn't have a Dark Bomb in hand. There wasn't a clean source of 3 damage. That's a Kezan Mystic Callum. Just to cut myself off again, this is not the first time we've seen this recently from Ecop. Ecop, in fact, played this list in the G2 class Legends or something very similar to it, where he brought Warlock as his class of choice and had Kezan Mystic in one of his builds to be able to counter matchups very much like this. But the Alexstrasza coming down here is pretty brutal, honestly, because... Ecop is a little bit short of ways to deal with this. He does have a small heal in hand with Earthen Ring, but he's missing the big heals. He does have that Lotheb, but...
Okay, so talking about the Antonidas turn in the Doomsayers as well.
Yeah.
Is it possible that Firebat was looking at a turn 9 Alexstrasza?
So, okay, I didn't actually get to finish my thoughts.
Things
so
like Siphon Soul.
The second Doomsayer was played, and Ecop's answer to that as a way of doing 3 additional damage was Hellfire, which suggests he doesn't have the Dark Bomb in hand. Right. So again, Firebat played Antonidas on the board, which again has 7 health, and there was 4 power on board. So Firebat's read was he had to use Hellfire last turn. That's the Hellfire gone. The fact that he used the Hellfire means that he doesn't have Dark Bomb. Therefore, there aren't many efficient answers for this Antonidas. The Owl was gone already. So it basically put it just on Siphon Soul as the only out that would be able to deal with it. Unfortunately, the Siphon Soul was present. I don't think it was a terrible play from Firebat. It was for sure ambitious, which is the word I used at the time, but there was a potential that it could have got the job done.
But going back to what I was saying, does it also, you know, if you do see a Siphon Soul,
yeah,
does it make you feel a little bit better about establishing Alexstrasza if you're Firebat?
Sure. There's the threat of Big Game Hunter still, of course, that couldn't have been used on the Antonidas that can be still used on the Alex. But sure, I guess that's a byproduct of it, where if the Siphon Soul is used, Firebat seems is more comfortable with having this big A8 on board. So it's a play that looked bizarre at first, but I guess Firebat just felt like he was in a good enough position here.
So are we looking at lethal here? 12, 15, 19, right?
How are you doing 19? So you fireball the...
Yeah, you can't play the Ice Lance as well, because we have the Thoris. And...
Yeah. So fireball...
It is lethal damage in hand.
It is, yeah. Over a series of turns, it is enough damage to do the job. But you can fireball the Belcher here, which allows you to push through 8 to face. You can use the Blizzard as well. So now we are getting to the situation where an answer to this 8-8 and some healing needs to be found. He does have Molten Giant Shadow Flame Lotheb if he wants to go down that route that can keep him alive. But it might just be time here.
Yeah, this matchup's gotten very tasty very quickly. They got down very low, both players, and they're both very close to being able to do something. Lotheb coming down to block this out.
Right, like I said, the state of this matchup is very much in flux. You know, I kind of described the standard path and the standard strategy of it, but it's one of those matchups where you really have to adapt to what your hand does. And what Firebat's hand did was a pile of burn and Alexstrasza. So that's just the route he's gone down. He's gone all in as early as possible, reduced the outs of his opponent or the amount of turns he's had to draw his outs. And he's been able to put on a ton of pressure here. And he's getting away with it so far because the Reno and the heal bot are just refusing to be drawn. But Jiraxxus is a small heal in itself, but remains to be seen whether that will be enough over the course of the game.
Yeah, that Kezzan Mystic could really come into play here, especially as we see the Mad Scientist and a lot of damage on the board for Ekop, which I don't know if Firebat's going to be able to... I mean, Firebat doesn't want a Blizzard, obviously, because of that 7-2 currently, but what he can do is he can trade the Scientist into the 7-2 and then Blizzard again to freeze the 5-5 and the Thaddeus.
Yes.
Which is going to come down. We're going to get to see a Thaddeus, more than likely, in our last game of the day.
Yeah, and that is a minion that is not going to get taken off the board, honestly, by a Freeze Mage. So it's going to have to be repeatedly frozen, or it's just going to have to be ignored and you rely on things like Ice Block. But if the situation comes down where Firebat is relying on Ice Block to hold, he might get a nasty Kezzan Mystic Shade surprise in his future.
Or you could just do Jiraxxus if you're Ekop.
Yep.
This turn.
This is a play, it pulls him back up to essentially 13, with the Mad Scientist still in play.
Roaring Torch picked up.
Roaring Torch picked up.
That's
lethal, yeah. Double Fireball essentially, plus the Frostbolt is the 15 that he needs. And Firebat is going to end our day for us in the second series, only the second to not go the distance to five games. Firebat picks up a 3-1. Joins the club of Ryzen, I believe, who was the other 3-1 winner, right?
Yeah.
Saves us a little bit of time. We get to get in an extra 10 minutes or 20 minutes or so of sleep here, Callum, which I'm sure we're very grateful for. But yeah, I mean, let's talk about, in a nutshell, what just happened there. Firebat with Freeze Mage won a matchup that most people would say he's unfavored in the first place against the Reno Lock, with an additional Kezzan Mystic teched in as well.
Yeah, absolutely incredible. Honestly, I think you would be hard-pressed to argue that Firebat is not the best Freeze Mage player in the world. There are other players like Tice who have played a lot of Freeze Mage as well.
I was going to throw Tice's name out there, and I've also got to give a shout-out to my boy Crane. The times I've seen him play Freeze Mage, I've been insanely impressed. People generally know him as just a patron player, but those would very much be my top three, I think.
Yeah, Firebat definitely up there. As I say, back in the early days of Conquest, he was bringing Freeze Mage, Face Hunter, and Rogue, right? Just every time.
Yeah, that was just the lineup. He'd got his spreadsheet out, he'd calculated everything, and that was apparently just the lineup. It's what he ran for a very long time, and it proved extremely successful for him.
Yeah, well, even though it was so predictable, he came and won the first Gfinity Spring Championship with that lineup, came back again with the same lineup. Same venue, same event, and won again.
Yep.
So, yeah, it shows just how good he is with those decks. And we saw the Rogue getting banned out. Maybe we get to see some of that tomorrow. Mm-hmm. But yeah, Firebat closing that out there. That was a really fun game to end the day on, the Reno Lock versus the Freeze Mage.
I love watching that matchup. I think it's so much fun. Just the amount of different routes that the matchup can take. We saw the really aggressive line in that game from the Freeze Mage, but it can just as easily go all the way deep to, one or two cards left in deck for both players where... Yeah, we've seen all the heals come out and all the burn come out and the Alex be used at the end of the game and all this stuff's happened. So it's such a widely varied matchup that there's always something new to talk about. So I love seeing that. I hope with the standard format coming out, we get to see more of that type of matchup and less of the kind of Secret Paladin and Druid type matchups. That's personally my dream for Hearthstone. Hopefully you guys out there can join me in this dream and we can push and get it done, guys. Come on.
All right, so we will be back here tomorrow for the top eight and all the way through to our final. We're going to be starting at 4:15 CET, 3:45 CET. We'll be starting with Kranich versus Sixo, And then we'll have Ryzen, who got the upset victory over Show against Orange, Zelay against Hoi, and Life Coach versus Firebat.
Yes.
Let's talk about Life Coach versus Firebat in the round of eight.
Yeah, I mean, if you're making a top 10 or maybe even a top 5 of, you know, all-time Hearthstone greats at this point, if we were going to preemptively form a Hall of Fame, I think those are two people that would be shoe-ins at this point to get in there. So seeing those two go up against each other is going to be a treat for sure.
The number one and number four prize money earners from last year.
Yeah.
Firebat came out on top of that list. Life Coach coming in fourth. One of only four, two of the only four players to clear six figures in prize money last year. So they have an impressive winning record.
Six figures playing video games, right? Like that's the dream, and these two guys are living it. So yeah, congrats to them.
Absolutely. It's gonna be a great day tomorrow. We'll have seven more games for you, and say we will crown our champion. $3,500 to the winner. Our $6,000 prize pool will be given out to our top four. Of course, this is the Wombology tournament brought to you by Wombo.gg, where you can play money matches against your friends and the pros in all manner of esports games, make your games a little bit more interesting, and our sponsors Shoe as well. As I say, we are live at 3:45 tomorrow here on this channel. Myself, I'm sorry, once again, will be hosting alongside Soto. Hopefully Soto will make up for it, getting to see some more of this Blizzard-approved sellout caster. And we will see you back here tomorrow. Thank you very much for watching.